story begins on the 17th of May, 1929, at 51 Old Market Place, Cork City Island. It begins with my grandmother's birth, Philomena Mary Dwyer, the second daughter of Anne and Dennis Dwyer. After her defining childhood in Cork, my grandmother, at the ripe age of 17, then pursues her future in nursing. This has her leave her homeland and head to London, where my grandmother takes her first role nursing in London's East End. By chance, her and a friend then transfer to a hospital in the English town of Dorset, where she meets my granddad, Arthur Thomas Cobley. Here they marry, have three children, Dennis, Martin and Mark, and begin their voyage by sea to the promised new land of Australia. By chance, they end up in Sydney, fresh-faced young parents with hopes of a new life. Their three kids grow up, all have kids of their own, and leave my grandparents with, to date, 8 grandchildren and 5 great-grandchildren. I, Shaun Cobley, son of Martin Thomas Cobley, set on a modern journey that takes me from my homeland of Australia to the place where it all began. Armed with my grandma's memoirs, I leave the city I currently live, London, England, and head to Ireland, where I begin my road trip to the peaceful village where my grandmother spent her childhood, the resting place of my grandfather. This is the road to Grenagh.
Some lessons and broke some rules. Now I bought Flight 101. The greatest export is our young Celtic tears are falling from these emigrant eyes. Now my heart, he lies over the foam. And Celtic hearts away in our emerald isle, for the day we will all come back home. Once a Celtic tiger roared, left a bite we all ignored. The legacy of our nation, generation, emigration. Though these roads are paved with gold, and southern summers rarely cold.
These are some words from grandmother's memoirs. My father, like an old war horse scenting battle, joined the Irish Army as a sergeant major. His job was to drill the local defence forces and teach him how to use a rifle. I felt my father was bored and unsatisfied with being a labourer. He was an intelligent man who needed to use his brain as well as his hands. He was posted to County Kerry, the next county to Cork, that could have been miles away as there was no transport. People didn't travel much outside their own area. He came home for leave twice a year. He used to cycle from town to town, no mean feat in such a barren, mountainous county, with long distances between hamlets and towns, accompanied by the cold winters and the highest rainfall in Ireland.
So, this is what I love about Ireland, just pulling over on the side of the road here. And
it's got these ruins, so let's have a look inside.
Stunning, the random stuff you'll come across here. Just like an old Chrysler There's the motorbike there. That's what it's all about, just the history, the randomness of why these cottages are empty and some of the bits and pieces you see, but this thatching up here, this roof, and just left to ruins. The old fireplace that would have heated the whole house, even upstairs here. The one main fireplace there. Anyway, let's continue on our Irish adventures. These are some words from Grandmother's memoirs, Another Time, Another Place. In this section, she's talking about her father. In 1929, my father was employed by the railways. He had been in the Irish Guards during the war, 1914 to 1918, and he served in the trenches in France. When he returned, he was extremely active in the IRA, the Irish Republican Army, and was part of the Cork Brigade. He fought in the Drupsy ambush, for which, through his services, was awarded a medal by the President of Ireland. He was an experienced soldier, and he achieved the rank of commander. During this period, he met my mother, but they did not marry until 1923. They were both in their 30s. Also from my grandma's memoirs, my father could be described as black Irish, tall at 6 foot, with jet black hair, brilliant blue eyes and fair skin. Always remember when he got sunburned. His cheek looked like sapphires in his face. My eyes, like my brother's, were a kind of smoky blue, and my hair was an auburn, my one beauty according to my mother, who decided its lack of curl. Shortly after my birth, in 1929, came the Great Depression of the early 30s, when everyone was worried about the economy. By this time, I had a new baby brother, William, Bill, as well as an elder brother, Ted, Timothy.
Granddaddy's granddaddy played the fiddle well at all the country dances in Drayton long ago. He hailed from Tipperary, but he made Australia home. He was quite a character, or so I have been told. Life's a song that continues on down through history. We all contribute a verse or two. What will yours be?
Here my grandmother talks about her grandfather. My grandfather was a wanted man and on the run. Often the house was searched and at odd times and without warning. My grandfather was at the time in Mallow, in a jail under a false name. His brother Michael was taken out to be shot. The Tans, as they were called, gave him a choice. If he could run fast enough, they wouldn't shoot him. Obviously he did, as he lived to reach 90 years. The Van der Weyers' 7 children, only 2 married. My father and his sister, Nora O'Sullivan.
Granddaddy's daddy named my granddaddy Jack, who together with my grandma raised a try the 6. Whether in the choir or at family sing-alongs, Jack was in his element, or so I have been told. Life's a song that continues on down through history. We all contribute a verse or two.
I've always considered my grandparents a major influence in all aspects of who I am. Thanks to my grandma's foresight and through these beautiful words she penned in 1983, just a year after I was born, I now have a window into the events and the people, not just the names and the places, but the emotions and the desires of my forefathers. And for this amazing gift, I am eternally grateful.
Anybody here from Cork? Good luck from, good luck on Sunday. Anybody from the north side?
Yeah!
Well, the next song Shaun is going to sing is dedicated to you. And what key do you say, Shaun? This is in the key of G.
When Irish eyes are smiling, sure, it's like a morning spring. In the lilt of Irish laughter, you can hear angels sing. When Irish harps are happy, all the world is bright and gay. But when Irish eyes are smiling, sure they'd steal your heart away. Oh, oh, if I had a partner, no, you're too late. Far across the yonder blue lies a true fairyland, with the sea rippling over the shingle and sand, where the gay honeysuckle is luring the bee, and the green glens of Antrim are calling to me. Sure, if only you knew how the light of the moon turns a blue Irish bay to a silver lagoon. You'd imagine the picture of heaven it would be, where the green glens of Antrim are calling. I'm going home this time. I've just stepped in to see you.
Okay, listen, we're going to take a quick break and
stay a while. I want to see how you're getting on. I want to see you smile. I'm happy to be back again to greet you one and all. But there's no place else on earth just like the homes of Donegal. Now the time has come when I must go. I bid you all adieu. The open highway calls me forth to do the things I do. But when I'm tramping far away, I'll hear your voices call. And please God, I'll soon return unto the homes of Donegal. Are you all ready to sing this time? There's one fair county in Ireland with memories so glorious and grand, where nature has lavished its bounty. It's the orchard of Erin's green land. Sure, I love its cathedral and city, once founded by Patrick so true. And it bears in the heart of its bosom the ashes of Brian. Let's hear you sing. It's my own Irish, far across the foam, far across. Although I've often left it, in foreign lands to roam, no matter.
Yeah.
the guys are stuck in a bit of traffic here. I'm just cruising into a little town called Caloglan, County Kerry, here in Ireland. It's a festival of the goat, so pretty exciting stuff. The locals, they've gone out and they've found this goat, male goat, and they've got the goat, and they're going to put the goat at the top of the tower. And there the goat will look out over the town. The goat's called King Puck. The locals, they go out, they find a nice, wild, good-looking male goat and put it to the top of the tower. And we're just cruising into town now. So 400 years old, it dates back to pagan times, actually. And I think it comes from when the English were invading and a goat got broke free, ran into town, and alerted them that the English were coming to raid the villages and that, so they all hid out and survived the raid. That's where it's apparently come from. It's known kind of all over Europe. It's one of the oldest fairs ever. And when I see the goat, go up to the goat tower, I'll film the goat and I'll show you all the goat, and then we can look at the goat together. It's gonna be fun, it's gonna be good. Can't wait. Here's the goat, behind the people. Goat, see, told you I'd show you a goat. Goat. Okay, the goat's about to go up the tower. As I said, I'll capture this for you. Let's check it out.
Right in the heart of Kerry lies the village of Killoglin, which every year holds Puck Fair. It's Ireland's largest and reputedly the oldest fair in the world. The town's population of 1,200 swells to some 100,000 for the 8-day event at which King Puck, a wild mountain goat, reigns supreme. During the fair, Killoglin is the only town in Ireland where the pubs and restaurants are permitted to remain open for 72 hours non-stop. It's a tradition greatly appreciated by locals and visitors. Even the horses take advantage of the occasion. A major feature of the fair is the sale of horses, ponies and cattle. And this young lady from the village plays the part of the Lady of the Lawn. She it is who will eventually crown King Puck. But before that, he has to be paraded through the streets. Now comes the coronation, and he becomes officially King of the Fair for 3 days and 2 nights. Meanwhile, he's carefully hoisted onto a specially built platform. The king patiently waits 52 feet up while his subjects get down to the serious business of celebrating.
Thank you. Hi there, Grandma. I've finally made it here to Lake County of Cork. In a little town here called Macaroon at the moment. Tried to capture as much of it as I can with the camera, and hopefully you like what I'm going to get. It's an old castle here in this little town, but I haven't got to Blarney or the centre of Cork yet, but can't wait.
She smiled as she passed by. He says, I am a stranger, and I'm lonely all alone. Would you kindly tell me where I'd find that little Blarney Stone? And the only Blarney Stone I knew was underneath the nose. So her eye had a smile was brought me, and she went a rogue aside. She set me at the jumping, till I thought I'd surely die. He rolled me in his arms, and I never gave a moan. She kissed the blue roses on the band of Blarney Stone. Blarney Stone and Kerry, it is a Blarney Stone and Clare. Blarney Stone and Wicklow and his Reggie and Grenadier. Blarney Stone and Sligo and another in Tyrone. So the little town in Ireland shall fight the Blarney
This next bit's my favourite bit of my grandma's memoirs, and it really connects with the same aspirations we have today. The question of my future was weighing on me. What would I, or what could I do? I'd toyed with the idea of becoming a nun, as I didn't think that anyone would want to marry me. My mother dismissed factory work, also domestic and shop work. They were all perceived as being just too common. Couldn't bear the thought of office work. I personally considered it to be too confining. This left me with teaching or nursing. Not too many careers were open to girls then. By this time I'd had enough of school, the constant, unremitting grind, and the hours of homework. It wouldn't be too bad if it led to something worthwhile, profession, but it didn't or couldn't. It seemed as if nursing was as close as I could get to my ambitions, which in me were always tied to reality. I'd learn not to cry for the moon, as I had to be satisfied with what I had. Also from my grandma's memoirs, I never knew my grandfather or grandmother. They both unfortunately died before I was old enough to get to know them. Later I learned things about them that made them like real people instead of shadowy figures in my background. I learned that my maternal grandmother was a lively dancer, a good cook and a cake maker. She was clever with her hands in all sorts of needlework, and she was an impetuous woman with a quick temper. All at once, she was a woman like me. All at once, my memories of a straight-laced old woman who was stern with her own children, as us, vanished. I now saw her with the same hopes and dreams as I had. I could see how she could elope with a policeman in defiance of her family. I could sense her grief when her 22-year-old son went down on the Titanic in 1912. She had to be locked in a bedroom for 3 days in case she would harm herself. She was the one who had given him the money to go to visit his sisters in America. She, like all our other forebearers, I discovered, began to assume flesh. They breathed, they wept, they felt joy like I did. I'd like my grandchildren to feel the same way as me,
journal is about change through generation to generation. Our aspirations remain constant, whatever century we are born in. I hope this glimpse of the past will help us to have a sense of identity and continuity. I am the bridge between the old world, Ireland and England, and the new Australia. If I should die before I have passed on what was passed on to me, well, the family law would have gone forever. I hope this law will be kept in trust for those who come after me. At this period in my life, I have more past than future. But whilst I have grandchildren, I shall always be a part of the future, as you too will be someday. God willing, may he bless you all. Philomena Mary Cobley. Have a look around the beautiful country setting in Grandma's old village, Grenagh, I believe. Came here earlier, it was a bit daunting trying to find it, so we searched them all, but we got here and found it. It is a beautiful stone as well. So as you walk into the cemetery, it's about halfway up, that's on the left hand side. I've got beautiful views of the countryside everywhere around. So here we are. Got a bit of a plan here for him. Now, I wasn't sure fully what it was he drank, but I spoke to Dad, gave Dad a quick call, and he said he didn't mind a Guinness. So we got him one of his favourite drinks, which I'll place out here for him, so he can have a bit of a beer, you know, relax a bit. Yeah. The sun's just come out right now. Look at that. Just brightened up massively. It's beautiful. So, it was unexpected, really, but what are the plans? We got him here. So, from all us grandkids in Australia, on behalf of everyone here. And we popped out and picked a few wildflowers also for him here. Got a bit of colour to it all. And then we also got him a candle. I'm going to try and pop back tonight and try and get some footage at night and maybe some photos, but we're getting some photos for everyone so that they can keep an eye on it. It's a bright sunny day, but I'll give this candle a bit of a light now. It's got the wind protector on it, so it'll stay light for a while. beautiful, beautiful place here. Ann and Dennis, who, to be honest, I definitely didn't really know, but it's great to feel, I guess, this close to my great grandparents in Ireland here. It's so far away from Australia, and one of those places that's kind of tricky to get to, but it's worth it when you get here, I guess. But I think we'll leave it with that. I'll get some photos for you and I'll email it to all you guys back home. Yeah, God bless.
The power of these words I hold, these words passed on by my grandmother, have unlocked a door to my past. I have a far greater knowledge of the epic voyage my grandparents went on in search of a better life. Although I have left my homeland of Australia, I myself moved to the bustle of London, just like my grandmother once did as a teenager. I, however, have never had to cross the globe by sea and embark on a voyage with three children in tow, shrouded by financial insecurity that meant I was most certainly on a trip to the great unknown. It's been their amazing courage and their fighting spirit that has shown over the duration of their lives that has paved the way for the future, the wonderful large family and the amazing lifestyle of all their descendants. That's my family, the Cobleys. I feel lucky. I'm born a son in a lucky country in Australia. I feel blessed that I've never lost a sibling when I was growing up. I feel blessed that my parents never stepped foot in trenches. The famine, the Titanic, poor medicine, the Great Depression, all ideas foreign from my upbringing. I feel lucky I've had a history that's beyond my own. I feel lucky I've had amazing people perform, documenting my family's journey. I feel blessed that I've experienced my grandparents' love. God bless the fact that I've even met multiple great-grandparents. Shall we all be inspired by those in our family that come before us? Thank you. I dedicate this film to my grandparents, Anne and Dennis, to their children, Nancy, William, Timothy, and Brendan Dwyer. Not least forgetting my amazing grandmother, Philomena Mary Dwyer, who has made this film happen. Most of all, I dedicate this film to my grandfather, Daddy Vermore, Arthur Thomas Cobley. I myself look to the future and even generations to come. I look through the names and what our lives have become. I see the Dwyers, O'Doherty's and Lynch's and Goldens, and Thomas Cobley's and Williams and towns now so old. McGillicuddy's, Hedison's, Luttrell's and Sinan's, names now forever, they're just pleasant reminders. I know fully where I'm heading, so our lives will go on. And thanks to those before me, I know fully where I'm from.